So it is my distinct honor to introduce the next speaker. I'm Chef AJ and I live in Los Angeles, and I'm about 20 minutes away from Hollywood, California, where we have the motion picture industry. And in Hollywood, when a woman is known as a triple threat, that means she not only can act, but she can sing and she can dance. Well, our next speaker is not a triple threat. She's actually a quadruple threat. Is that she not only is one of the most brilliant minds in plant-based nutrition, but she also has a passion for the environment and compassion for the animals, and she can cook. I know this because I watched her in an Iron Chef, and I'm going to be competing against her in Baltimore November 4th in an Iron Chef. Have you ever seen a grandmother look like this? Almost 60 years old. And did you know that she can actually do her age in push-ups? And I'm hoping she'll show you. Ladies and gentlemen, Brenda Davis.
So this presentation is on deconstructing paleo and keto diets. And this is just my disclosure. Quick outline, we're going to talk a little bit about the history of low-carb diets. We'll talk a little bit, just define the keto and the paleo diet, and talk a little bit about the differences between the two. And then we're going to spend some time digging deeper into keto and paleo claims. We'll talk about plant-based versus keto-paleo, and we'll wind up with talking about low-carb diets, the good, the bad, and the ugly. So a little bit about the history of low-carb diets. The earliest record I could find of the use of these types of diets was in the 1800s, when ketogenic diets were used to treat diabetes. And believe it or not, in 1869, the first appearance of a low-carb diet for the treatment of overweight and obesity appeared. It was called the Banting Diet, and it's recently been reinvented, and you can see this little Banting pocketbook guide. In 1921, the beginning of the use of ketogenic diets to treat epilepsy. And then in 1958, sort of modern era of low-carb diets for treatment of overweight. And this Eat Fat and Grow Slim, and then this one I thought was rather interesting, the Drinking Man's Diet. And believe it or not, you fuel your body with a mix of ketones and alcohol. Really brilliant. And then 1967, you might remember the Stillman Diet. And then in 72, this was sort of when the low-carb craze really took hold with the Dr. Atkins Diet Revolution. And then 1979, really the first paleo-type diet appeared, and it was called the Stone Age Diet book. In 78, the Scarsdale Diet. 92, the Atkins Diet Revolution. It a little bit more liberal than his 72 diet. And then in 1999, we had the birth of the Weston A. Price Foundation. You heard a little bit about them already. But they really promote a very high animal fat diet, and they are very anti-vegetarian. And then in 2002, we had the paleo diet got a huge shot in the arm with Lauren Cordain's book, The Paleo Diet. 2003, we got South Beach, and then 2007, we started to see a bunch of books and articles from Gary Taubes. And then 2013, believe it or not, paleo diets became number one in Google weight loss methods searches. And then 2016, is when keto diets, actually I think almost surpassed paleo diets, becoming all the rage. So what is a ketogenic diet, or a keto diet for short? Well, it's basically an eating plan that's very low in carbohydrates and very, very high in fat. As we mentioned earlier, they were originally designed to treat diabetes and epilepsy, and they're now among the most popular weight loss diets. As you probably are well aware. The basic premise is if the body doesn't have access to glucose, which is of course our preferred fuel through the diet, We will burn off our glycogen stores, and then the body will enter a state of ketosis where an alternative fuel called ketones are produced to supply the body's energy needs. And it puts this is what is spouted off, it puts the body into a high fat burning state where stored fats are released, and of course this promotes weight loss. And just so you know, there are three types of ketone bodies. Acetoacetate, which is technically a ketone, and it gets converted quite quickly to beta-hydroxybutyric acid, which is BHB or acetone. And BHB is the one ketone that's actually not technically a ketone, but it looks like a ketone, smells like a ketone, and so it's, for all intents and purposes, it's used and thought of as a ketone. So just so you know, this is the macronutrient sort of distribution of the keto diets that are used mainly for weight loss. So about 75% of calories from fat, about 20 from protein, and about 5 from carbohydrates. And so this varies a little bit, sometimes a little higher in fat and lower in protein, but carbohydrates are almost always 5% or less. This is the classic ketogenic diet that's used for epilepsy. It's about 90% fat, 6 to 8% protein, and 2 to 4% carbohydrate. It's quite shocking, actually. So the keto used for weight loss is a little more liberal. So what foods are permitted? Well, basically you're looking at the base of the pyramid being meat, and eggs and high-fat dairy. Milk isn't allowed because it's got too many carbohydrates, but cheese is, and sour cream is. Fats and oils, lots of them, and then some green vegetables, a little bit of nuts, seeds, and berries. And you can see on the bottom, anything with any appreciable amount of carbohydrate is eliminated. And I guess it kind of boils down to, and this is taken directly from a keto website, eat fat, eat meat, poultry, eggs, and fish, the fattier the better, eat non-starchy vegetables, and that's it. This is a sample recipe, just to give you a flavor for the type of food these people are eating. So 3 pounds of ground beef and 6 cups of cheese, and then a little bit of peppers thrown in. And so you've got, in 1/8 of the recipe, almost 800 calories, about 61 grams of fat, which is 70% of the calories, about 30 grams of saturated fats, 7 grams or about 4% of calories from carbohydrate, 49 grams of protein, 205 milligrams of cholesterol, and less than 0.5 gram of fiber. Okay? So what is a paleo diet? Well, a paleo diet is a pattern of eating that attempts to mimic the diet of our Paleolithic ancestors. And it goes by all sorts of names, the caveman diet, the primal diet, the Stone Age diet. The basic premise is what humans ate in pre-agricultural times is the diet best suited to our genetic makeup. The shift from a hunting-gathering diet, which is rich in wild meat and wild plants, to an agricultural diet rich in grains and legumes gave rise to our obesity and chronic disease epidemics. So that's what they believe. So the paleo macronutrients, you can see about 50% of calories from fat, about 30 from protein, and about 20 from carbohydrate. Okay, so quite a lot different than keto. And here's their pyramid, and you can see a lot of similarities with keto. So the base is meat, and then some fruits and vegetables and nuts and berries at the top. And their slogan is, if a caveman couldn't eat it, neither should you. And so the same things are eliminated, the grains and the legumes and so forth. So here's a sample recipe, and you can see, coconut oil, pork tenderloin, but there's a greater number of vegetables, green beans and snap peas and red peppers and carrots, some coconut milk. And you've got, for about a half the recipe, about 643 calories, about 53% of calories from fat, 37 grams. And 54 grams of protein, or 34% of calories, and 24 grams of carbohydrate, about 15% of calories, 147 milligrams of cholesterol, and a lot more fiber than in the keto sample recipe, so 8 grams of fiber. So let's compare keto, or paleo and keto, or keto and paleo. And so you can see here, in purple here, we've got the things that are similar between these two diets, and here we've got the things that are different. And so if you look here, meat, poultry, fish, and eggs are high in both types of diets. Nuts and seeds are included in both. Green vegetables are included in both. Legumes are excluded in both. Grains are excluded in both. And now the differences. So dairy, well, it's excluded in a paleo diet, but the keto diet is actually very high cheese and fatty dairy. And other non-starchy vegetables are included in paleo, and they're limited in keto. Starchy vegetables are limited in paleo. They're completely excluded in keto. Fruits are very moderate in paleo, and they're minimized in keto. Concentrated fats and oils are moderate in paleo, and they are extremely high in keto, just to give you an idea of the differences. So, and the macronutrients, just recall, here's keto and here's paleo. So you can see a lot more protein in paleo, considerably less fat, even though it's high fat. And the carbohydrate restriction in keto diets is less than 5% of calories from carbohydrates. Other low-carb diets tend to range from about 6 to 20% carbohydrates. Paleo is actually at the highest end of that range. So how many grams of carbohydrates are we talking about? Well, keto is usually around 20. And sometimes up to 25, but not usually too much higher than that. Paleo is around 100, and other low-carb diets are usually somewhere in between. And so I just want to show you this. Here you have the carbohydrate, the percentage of calories from carbohydrates in various plant foods. And you can see all plant foods, from non-starchy vegetables to fruits, with one exception, contain between about 58 and 92% of calories from carbohydrates. How many does keto allow? 5%. How many does paleo allow? About 20%. Okay, so just so you recall that. So here you've got plant foods. Milk is about 37% carbohydrate, whereas cheese is about 3%. Nuts and seeds about 12%, so you can have some, but not huge quantities of those either. And then here is the carbohydrates in non-starchy vegetables. So keto says, oh, you can eat non-starchy vegetables, but there are several non-starchy vegetables that contain over 10 grams per cup. And so you would be limited if you can only have 20 grams per day, right? And then there are several that are some 6 to 9 grams of carbohydrate, and others that are less than, you know, under 5. And the ones that are the lowest are the, you know, the leafy greens, because they have almost no calories. So you don't get a lot of carbohydrates because you don't get a lot of calories. So you can eat a fair bit of those. But I want to show you the carbohydrate content of other foods. And remember the numbers, 20 grams a day for keto, 100 grams a day for paleo. And so what you can see is over 20 grams in all of these foods, from, you know, grains and beans, and even an apple's got 30 grams of carbohydrate, a banana 27. You've got blueberries, one cup is 21. So they say you can eat berries, but you couldn't eat a whole cup. You'd be over the 20 grams. And you wouldn't be able to eat anything else that day that has any carbohydrates. So just to give you, you know, a better idea of what we're talking about here. And then you can see moderate amounts in, you know, the winter squash and strawberries, and milk has about 11 grams per cup. And then you can see very low amounts of carbohydrates in, you know, cream cheese, sour cream cheese, butter, oil, lard, meat, chicken, fish, and eggs. Have none, of course. So which is more healthful, a keto diet or a paleo diet? Well, yeah, exactly, because keto is the most extreme type of low-carb diets. It's mainly fat and meat. Plant foods are heavily restricted, whereas paleo is the least extreme of the low-carb diets. It allows more liberal intake of plant foods, which means it's more healthful because it's got higher levels of plant foods, thus of protective nutrients like fiber and phytochemicals and antioxidants and sterols and stanols and all of those good things. So let's dig a little deeper into the keto diet. So there are probably 10 or 12 common claims, but I picked 6 common claims of keto diets. So first, that they induce rapid weight loss. Second, they improve brain function. Third, they improve endurance performance. Fourth, they reduce diabetes risk. Number 5, reduce cardiovascular disease risk. And number 6, increase longevity. So let's take a look at what we know. So first, that keto diets induce rapid weight loss. Well, the claim is that a keto diet is a very low-carb diet which turns the body into a fat-burning machine. And the theory is that we get a sort of metabolic advantage when the body is retrained to use fat instead of glucose as an energy source. And one of the things that happens is you get a tremendous suppression in appetite. Ghrelin, which is the hormone that makes you hungry, doesn't increase in ketosis like it increases in other weight loss diets. So it's a huge advantage. You don't care if you don't eat much. And so we have some evidence. The short-term evidence, we have actually quite a number of reports that say, yes, you lose a significant amount of weight. In these are trials of about 3 weeks to 4 months. And generally, we see favorable changes in body composition and markers of inflammation because of the weight loss. But the evidence long-term is a little bit of a different story. We have a 2013 meta-analysis of 13 randomized controlled trials. And what they found is over a year, keto compared to low fat, and low fat was just less than 30% of calories from fat, the keto folks lost about 2 pounds more in that year than the low fat folks. So not a huge difference, but they did have lower triglycerides, they had higher LDL and HDL cholesterol, and there were no significant differences in blood pressure, fasting glucose, insulin, A1C, or C-reactive protein. However, weight loss was quite similar in both groups at 2 years. So this is sort of the longest term study we have. We also have a metabolic ward study of just 17 people, but this was interesting because they compared keto with a baseline diet of about 50% of calories from carbohydrates. And basically, one of the big claims of the keto movement is that it increases your metabolism or your energy expenditure by 300 or 400 or 500 calories a day. And in this study, they actually found that the energy expenditure was less than predicted. It did give an advantage, but the advantage was less than 100 calories a day, greater fat burning or whatever, greater calorie burning. But the benefit actually waned over time. And body fat loss was no greater with the keto than with the regular diet. But what was really interesting is the loss of fat-free mass was greater, or muscle mass, obviously, with the keto diet, which is not a good thing. So the verdict here is keto diets promote weight loss and appear more effective than many other diets for accelerating short-term weight loss. However, they don't offer a significant weight loss advantage over other diets long-term, and they do have some potentially serious downsides. In fact, the U.S. News Best Diet Rankings of 2018, I don't know if you're aware of these, but these diet rankings are the product of many scientists that are brought together to really take a good look at the science of these diets. And out of 40 diets, in the best diets overall category, keto tied for last place. And in the best diets for healthy eating, keto ranked number 40 or last place. Why? Because the diet is extremely high in fat and saturated fat and in fatty animal products, and it has a very high potential for nutritional deficiencies of fiber and potassium, folate, magnesium, vitamin C, and all of the nutrients that are concentrated in plant foods. And it has multiple adverse side effects, which we'll talk a little bit more about later. You know, there are lots of ways to lose weight. Anything that promotes an energy deficit will promote weight loss. It doesn't mean it's healthful. And I love this. This is 1929. The big movement of the day was reach for a Lucky to lose weight. And here you can see all of their advertisements. You know, and this was a very successful marketing campaign telling people to have a cigarette instead of a sweet to avoid weight gain. And so, yeah, it works. You can lose weight doing that. Probably not a good plan, though. Number two, improve brain function. And so the claim here is various types of low-carb and ketogenic diets are effective at reducing seizures in patients with drug-resistant epilepsy, and they can improve memory in older adults, help reduce migraines, and reduce symptoms of Parkinson's disease. So the theory is keto diets work for epilepsy and several brain disorders because they provide an alternative fuel for brain cells. They increase the number of mitochondria or energy factories in the And they reduce free radical production, they reduce protein tangles, and they reduce insulin secretion and insulin resistance. So that's kind of the theory. What's the evidence? Well, for epilepsy, we know that 36 to 85% of patients with epilepsy experience more than a 50% seizure reduction with ketogenic diets. Epileptic syndromes are especially responsive to keto diets. And one example is the GLUT1 deficiency. It's a rare genetic mutation resulting in a shortage of this glucose transport protein. And so if you don't have glucose transport protein, you'll have a difficult time using glucose in your brain. So an alternative fuel will certainly help. So switching to this alternative fuel reduces seizures and improves cognitive function across epilepsy subtypes. If we look at other brain disorders, we really have only very preliminary evidence. There's possible benefits for APOE4 allele negative patients. Cognitive function, there's some evidence for benefit with animal studies. Migraines, we got a few case reports, one observational study. Parkinson's disease, there's one study that suggested improvement in motor and non-motor symptoms. So very, very limited research. The verdict for epilepsy is that it is effective for infants, children, and adolescents or adults, especially those who are not controlled with medication, and it does improve cognitive function in affected individuals. For other brain disorders, the research is pretty much inconclusive, but preliminary evidence suggests some potential benefits in conditions in which the pathogenesis includes abnormalities in cellular energy utilization. So pretty limited. But certainly therapeutically, I think there may be some use there. Improved, and number three is improved endurance performance. And the claim here is if you're an endurance athlete and you haven't looked into the benefits of ketosis or endurance performance, you're potentially missing out on a massive edge over your competition. And this is just, I just pulled these quotes off websites that are promoting keto diets. So this is the kind of claim that's being made. The theory is ketone bodies can improve mitochondrial function and serve as an alternative fuel source, and that they can increase the rate of fatty acid metabolism during exercise while preserving muscle glycogen stores for later stages of an event. And the evidence, we've got 8 small studies on humans, between 5 and 42 participants each, and the time frame is 4 days to about 10 weeks. And despite consistent fat loss with the keto diet, most studies reported actually reduced performance. And here are the studies, and you can see we've got, you know, reduced peak power, reduced mean power, reduced recovery, reduced VO2 max, time to exhaustion, and so on and so on, reduced performance and high activity. We've got no change in a couple of the studies, one slight benefit here, and only one study that consistently showed improved performance. And this one, they did find some improved performance with moderate intensity, but overall, you can see it's fairly negative. The verdict is, despite some positive findings, fat may be unable to produce energy fast enough to meet the demands of the muscles of athletes, especially for endurance events. The fourth claim has to do with diabetes, and the claim is that there is an overwhelming amount of research suggesting a low-carbohydrate, high-fat, ketogenic diet may help ease symptoms of diabetes, or in some cases, completely eliminate diabetes. And they go on to say keto can help people with or at risk for by promoting weight loss, improving insulin sensitivity, regulating your hunger hormones to reduce food cravings, increase your levels of good cholesterol, improve your A1C markers. And the theory is with minimal carbohydrate intake, your body will naturally have lower blood sugar levels and you won't need insulin to move sugar into your cells. Keto diets have powerful fat-burning effects, produce weight loss, and improve insulin sensitivity. So that's the theory. The evidence for short-term is actually pretty good. Weight loss, improved glucose control, reduced A1C, lower triglycerides, and fewer medications in the short term. We have no studies for the long term using keto diets. However, we have some low-carb studies that are not necessarily ketogenic, and they show pretty consistently favorable short-term, less favorable long-term consequences. There was a systematic review of studies that had looked at changes for at least 12 weeks, and no differences in weight or A1C was seen with long-term treatment. However, there are some really big concerns with people with diabetes. Ketogenic diets are associated with fatty liver, systemic glucose intolerance, insulin resistance, insufficient insulin secretion, reduced beta and alpha cell mass, fatty liver, dyslipidemia, and inflammation. I think I said fatty liver twice there. And although studies in humans are quite limited, so a lot of these studies were done on animal models, unfortunately. The verdict, while there are some favorable changes in the short term, long-term benefits have not been demonstrated, and the risks are really very significant. The fifth claim has to do with cardiovascular risk, and here the claim is that there are numerous studies reflecting the safety and superiority of ketogenic diet for use with cardiovascular risk factors in both adults and children. And the theory is that ketogenic diets improve metabolic risk factors such as low HDL, cholesterol, high triglycerides, inflammation, oxidative stress, insulin resistance, hypertension, and thereby they will reduce overall risk. The evidence, well, we've got two research teams, one from 2002 to 2004, that showed increased total LDL and HDL cholesterol with a keto diet, but decreased triglycerides and fasting insulin. And then another team showed pretty much the same thing, but also improved particle size. So more large, fluffy LDL, fewer small, dense LDL. And then we have three meta-analyses, 2012, 2013, and 2016, that again showed lower they compared low-fat diets and keto diets, and the low-fat diets consistently produced reductions in total and LDL cholesterol, and the high-fat diets produced lower triglycerides, increased HDL, but they also increased total and LDL cholesterol. In children with epilepsy, a number of studies from 2015 to 2017 reported that the keto diet consistently promoted negative changes in lipid profile, particle size, and they increased atherogenic risk. And so increased total and LDL cholesterol, they actually increased triglycerides, increased oxidative stress, and resulted in unfavorable changes in particle size. And if we look at some of the interesting studies that have looked at cardiovascular disease and low-carb diets, in 2010, we saw a study where they found with high low-carb diets that derived a lot of their protein from animal foods, increased risk of mortality about 14%, but a low-carb diet that derived protein from plant foods, it was a decreased risk of 23%. Then in 2012, looking at cardiovascular disease incidence, the lowest carbohydrate intakes increased risk 60%. And what they actually quantified it and said daily a reduction of 20 grams of carbohydrate and an increase in 5 grams of protein increased cardiovascular disease risk by 5%. So kind of interesting there. And then the last one, Lee, in 2014, they reported that for cardiovascular disease mortality, low carbohydrate with animal protein mainly increased risk of cardiovascular disease or cardiovascular disease mortality 51%. And with low carb plant based diet, there was no association, no increase in mortality. So the verdict is keto and low-carb diets tend to reduce intake of foods most strongly associated with cardiovascular disease protection. high fiber, fruits, vegetables, legumes, whole grains, and they increase the intake of foods that are associated with cardiovascular disease risk, like protein from animal sources and saturated fat. And the last claim that I want to look at for keto diets is the claim that they increase longevity. And here's some of the claims. If we want to live longer, we need to look after our mitochondria. A growing number of studies seem to suggest one way of doing this may be through a ketogenic diet. Its effects on mitochondrial function are almost too good to be true. And more claims. This one I thought was kind of interesting. Eating a high carbohydrate diet does not only make us fat, it makes us sick, senile, and makes our journey to the other worlds more painful and often faster. The only reason why some people still deny it, like global warming, is not the lack of evidence, but the lack of willingness to change the comforting habits. So, and I want to share this with you because I think it's important for us to know what's being said. The theory is ketogenic diets mimic the metabolic states of fasting or caloric restriction and increase longevity. And the ketone body, BHB or hydroxybutyric acid, may help regulate inflammation, gene expression, and promote longevity. So the evidence in terms that's favorable is we have two 2017 studies that reported increased midlife longevity using ketogenic diets in mice. It improved memory and health span, we have absolutely zero human studies. However, we do have some randomized control trials that have looked at low-carb diets and longevity. And you can see here, again, with a low-carb animal diet, overall mortality was increased 23%, and low-carb plant diet decreased 20%. So these obviously aren't ketogenic because you couldn't get a plant diet that was ketogenic. In this one, low-carb animal-based diet increased risk or increased mortality risk 33%. And then this 2018 study, you see a 32% increase in mortality risk with the lowest intakes of carbohydrates. And we've got another meta-analysis from 2013, 17 studies, over 250,000 participants, and the lowest carbohydrate consumers had a 31% increased risk of mortality compared to the highest carbohydrate consumers. And they say this should provide physicians with an incentive to pay attention to the considerable potential adverse effects on health if such diets are implemented without considering the nature of the carbohydrates and the sources of the protein. And you can see here this graph, which I thought was quite interesting. Here's mortality and carbohydrate intake, increasing percentage of calories from carbohydrate, and you get the highest risk of mortality with the lowest intakes of carbohydrate, and then you get sort of the lowest risk at about 50% of calories from carbohydrate, and then you get a little bit of an increase when we go up to 70, 80% of calories from carbohydrate. However, there's an explanation for this. So low carbohydrate, the lowest carbohydrate intake increased risk 32%. The highest carbohydrate increased risk of mortality 23%. The lowest risk was at 50 to 55%. Mortality increased 18% when the carbohydrate was exchanged for animal, when carbohydrate was exchanged for animal-derived fat or protein. So if you were getting animal-derived foods, you were increasing your risk. And it actually decreased, and I apologize, there's a mistake on your handout there. It says increased, but it's decreased. Mortality decreased 18% when the substitutions were plant-based. Now, this is the part that you'll be interested in here, is that this high carbohydrate, this increase here was actually associated with refined carbohydrates. So it was in poor countries where they're living on white rice and soda. So I think they would have seen something very different if the carbohydrates were coming from whole plant foods that were high in fiber and phytochemicals and so on. The conclusion, these data provide further evidence that animal-based low-carbohydrate diets, which are more prevalent in North American and European populations, should be discouraged. So how much carbohydrates do the world's healthiest people eat? Well, if we look at blue zone macronutrient intakes, We see carbohydrate intakes ranging from about 37% of calories to about 85% of calories. And on average, in the blue zones, they get about 62% of their calories from carbohydrate, about 25% from fat, and about 12% from protein. And the Samane in Bolivia, South America, I don't know if you've ever heard of the Samane, but this is a traditional hunter-gatherer group that have the lowest reported levels of chronic disease of any population in the world. And their diet is 14% protein, 14% fat, and 72% carbohydrate. So that tells us something as well. The verdict is, as far as longevity goes, I think Michael Pollan said it well, eat food, mostly plants, not too much. In summary, the keto benefits are really quite clear. There's some benefits for epileptic seizure reduction in certain people, for decreased energy intakes, for weight loss, for improved blood sugar, and for decreased triglycerides, increased HDL. And that's about it. The risks in the short term are increased LDL, impaired glucose tolerance, worsening kidney function, reduced athletic performance, bone loss, vitamin and mineral deficiencies, constipation, weakness, fatigue, bad breath, muscle cramps, and headaches. In the long term, increased all-cause mortality, increased exposure to persistent organic pollutants that induce metabolic disorders and increased risk of birth defects, impaired artery function, increased total and LDL cholesterol, kidney stones, nutrient deficiencies, and non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So not good. So let's dig a little deeper into the paleo diet. So one of the main claims is when people start, and sorry, this one isn't in your, I added this last night. So when people start eating paleo, they often lose weight, they feel less hungry, they have fewer cravings for sugar, their skin clears up, they've got more energy, they find that muscles start appearing where they had only had flab for years. This way of eating can literally reverse diabetes, reduce your chances of getting cancer, reduce inflammation in your joints, it can help you avoid heart disease. Many people even get off their antidepressants and other medications. So what we know is that our native diet supported early humans through about a 2 to 4 decade lifespan. Regardless, let's assume it is a good idea to eat like our ancestors. The first question we would want to ask is, what did our ancestors eat? And we know that pre-agricultural people ate wild plants, animals, fish, and insects. The balance of these foods varied with time frame, location, season, gathering and hunting skills, tools, and culture. And it changed over time. During the first 80% of the Paleolithic period, humans were basically vegetarians, or I should say vegans, because they certainly didn't drink the milk of other species. Then during the last 20% of the Paleolithic period, humans ate a hunter-gatherer style diet. So what didn't they eat? Well, they didn't eat anything from a box or a bag. They didn't eat deep fried or fast foods. They didn't eat refined fats, oils, sugar, or salt. They didn't eat the milk of other mammals or products made from that milk. They didn't eat any bacon, ham, salami, sausage, or other processed meats. And they didn't drink alcohol. So do new paleo diets, the ones that people are eating today, actually equal true Paleolithic diets? And that question I asked myself, and I went to nutritional anthropology to find the question. And there are two studies that have actually estimated quite carefully the intakes of true Paleolithic man. The first was by Boyd Eaton and Melvin Connor, and that was way back in 1997. And the second was 25 years later, same authors, Melvin Connor and Boyd Eaton. And what they stated in this 25-year later study was early ancestral diets were overwhelmingly plant-based, with some insects and very small amounts of animal flesh. Reliance on meat increased in later ancestral diets as hunting skills improved. However, much proof points to continued significant, if not predominant, dependence on plant foods. So this is what I want to show you here. You've got the dietary recommended intakes for macronutrients. Here's the 1997 estimates, and here's the revised 2010 estimates. And so we're looking at about 3,000 calories a day were typical. Protein was about 25 to 30% of calories. Carbohydrates, they originally said 45 to 50, but they changed that to increase the range from 35 to 65, acknowledging great variations in consumption patterns throughout the world. Fat, an estimated 20% in 97, they increased it to 20 to 35 in 2010. Saturated fat, somewhere 6 to 12%. Cholesterol around the 500, the omega-6 to omega-3 ratio around the 2 to 1, and fiber around 104 is what they originally suggested to, and then the change to 70 to 150 plus. So is there anything that kind of jumps out at you when you look at this? Fiber, yeah, look at this, it's crazy. 104, how much does the average vegan get? 40, 50, 60, 70 maybe? These guys were eating 100 plus grams of fiber, especially the people eating, you know, some Paleolithic people ate 2/3 plants, 1/3 animals, some ate 2/3 animals, 1/3 plants. So the people eating 2/3 animals were still getting 70 grams of fiber a day. So this is a truckload of plants. This is quite interesting. Now look at the micronutrients. There's a few things that jump out at us here as well. Vitamin C. 500 to 600 milligrams a day. Look at this, calcium, 1,000 to 2,000 milligrams a day. Potassium, over 7,000 to 10,000 milligrams a day. Where do these nutrients come from? Plants, vitamin C, potassium, calcium. They didn't get calcium from milk, they didn't drink milk. It was all from, or largely from plants. So then when I looked at all of this nutritional anthropology, I said to myself, gosh, I wonder what comes closer to a true Paleolithic diet, a paleo diet or a 100% plant-based diet. So I did the math. I went to a paleo website and I took 3 days of menus and analyzed them. And then I took 3 days of recommended plant-based menus and analyzed them. And we just used the menus from our book, which made it simple. And then I compared to a true Paleolithic diet. And here's what we have. Of course, I had to make all of these diets 3,000 calories, so we're comparing fairly. And so when they were all made to 300 or adjusted to 3,000 calories, here's what we got. We got the new Paleo diet coming closer to a true Paleo diet because they were at 32% protein and true Paleo is 25 to 30. The vegan was at about 15%. Carbohydrate, the vegan diet's closer. Fat, the vegan diet's closer. Saturated fat, the vegan diet's closer. Cholesterol, well, there's no cholesterol in the vegan diet, so I gave it to the new Paleo folks. The ratio of N6 to N3 was actually better in the vegan diet. Fiber, of course, was much closer on the vegan or 100% plant-based diet. If we look at micronutrients, well, vegan wins for the first four, paleo wins for the next two, and vegan wins for the next four. And in summary, the paleo diet came closer to a true Paleolithic diet for four nutrients: protein, cholesterol, zinc, and vitamin A. Well, cholesterol is not exactly a nutrient, but anyway. And plant-based came closer for 13 nutrients. Okay, so the plant-based diet is actually closer nutritionally to a true Paleolithic diet than what people are calling paleo today. So the macronutrient discrepancies in this new paleo versus true Paleolithic diet, well, fat, you can see here, the total fat was about double the estimated Paleolithic value, about 53% versus about 20 to 35%. Saturated fat, 2 to 3 times higher than a true Paleolithic diet. Cholesterol, 2.5 times higher than a true Paleolithic diet. Carbohydrate in this new paleo diet is about a quarter to a half of what it actually was in real Paleolithic times. And fiber was about a third of what it was in true Paleolithic times. So why the discrepancy? You know, and this, people are scratching their head going, well, how could this be? Because in Paleolithic times, they were eating meat and plants, and people eating paleo diets are eating meat and plants. Well, the reason for the discrepancy, there's a few reasons, but the paleo folks today focus on achieving protein intakes to match Paleolithic times. So they put all their weight on protein and eat a lot of meat. And they don't put much emphasis on trying to achieve 70 to 150 grams of fiber, or 7,000 plus milligrams of potassium, or 500 plus milligrams of vitamin C. And what a lot of people don't realize is wild foods do not equal farmed foods. Meat and vegetables consumed today bear little resemblance to those eaten by pre-agricultural populations. And of course, oil and salt were used in these recipes of the new paleo folks, and that wasn't used in true Paleolithic times. If you look at wild versus domestic meat, meat from wild animals is about 6 to 16% of energy from fat. And in domestic animals, it's about 30 to 60%. So very, very different. And wild meat is much lower in saturated fat and much higher in omega-3s. And of course, wild meat was free in those times, probably, of antibiotics, added hormones, environmental contaminants, all of those things. So what about wild versus domestic plants? Well, cultivated vegetables and fruits have been bred for appearance, palatability, transportability, digestibility, and yield. Wild plants deliver over 3 times the fiber per gram compared to commercial plants, about 13.3 grams per 100 grams versus about 4.2 in our commercial foods. So that helps explain the whole fiber thing. And wild plants tend to be more concentrated in vitamins, minerals, and protein. So what we've learned here is the paleo diet does not equal a true Paleolithic diet. So what about the claims for reduced disease risk? Well, we have a whole rash of impressive short-term trials showing, you know, reduced body weight, increased satiety, improved lipid profiles, and improved insulin sensitivity, less inflammation, reduced blood pressure. Why the favorable results? Well, less refined grains, less refined sugars, less refined fats and oils, no fast foods, no fried foods, no processed meat, no high-fat dairy products, or no dairy products, period, no alcohol. At least technically, that's what people on a paleo diet would be eating. But we have to recognize that clinical trial paleo diets do not equal popular paleo diets. The clinical trials actually try to replicate true Paleolithic diets as well as they can. So they serve free-range, low-fat meat. They serve generous portions of vegetables and fruits. And they, you know, the paleo websites are much more liberal. They use, you know, processed meats and pepperoni as their snack, and oil and salt, and they're very much less reflective of true Paleolithic diets. And I think what people need to realize is, to me, this is a short-term gain for long-term pain. Because while paleo diets may induce weight loss and favorable lab results in the short term, there are really significant concerns about adopting such diets in the long term. And those concerns have to do with these diets are extremely high in meat. And so we're talking about high intakes of animal protein, high intakes of agrochemicals, high intakes of carnitine, which can be converted to TMAO, endotoxins, which are the gram-negative bacteria, especially in ground meat, that can be quite toxic and quite inflammatory, environmental contaminants like persistent organic pollutants like dioxins and PCBs, heme iron, which is a prooxidant, new 5-GC, which is a pro-inflammatory molecule in meat, nitrosamines, products of oxidation, saturated fat and cholesterol, and of course we get an upregulation of cancer-promoting genes with meat consumption. So how much meat do people eating paleo actually consume? Well, the typical recommendation, eat 30% of your calories from protein, would be 150 grams of protein in a 2,000 calorie diet and 210 grams of protein in a 2,800 calorie diet. So let's assume that a person eating paleo gets 80% of their protein from meat and 20% from plants. They would need to be eating 16 ounces of meat a day in a 2,000 calorie diet and 22 ounces of meat a day in a 2,800 calorie diet. So how much meat is actually safe to eat? Well, according to Walter Willett, who you heard about earlier today, if you step back and look at the data, the optimum amount of red meat you should eat should be zero. And he and I skipped a couple of slides that were in there, which are very useful slides, but I wanted to cut a couple of slides. So if you look at what we have on red meat and mortality, you can see a very consistent pattern. So here we've got this is processed meat in the pink, 44% increased risk of mortality, 20%, 23, 22, 15. This is unprocessed red meat in the brighter red, and you can see, you know, basically mostly between 10 and 15%. There's 1-5% there. And then total red meat, about a 29% or a 17% increase in mortality risk. And you may be aware of this study. This is the Levine study. They looked at over 6,000 participants age 50 plus, and it was an 18-year follow-up, and they found that in people consuming more than 20% of calories from protein, and remember, paleo is 30% of calories from protein, we had a 74% increase in mortality risk, 433% increase in cancer deaths, and a 393% increase in diabetes risk. That's about four times for cancer and diabetes. And the associations were abolished or greatly attenuated when that protein came from plants. So these numbers were only valid when the protein came from meat. And then we've got this, a very important study. This is the Harvard Health Professionals study from 2016. They looked at animal versus plant protein, and over 130,000 participants followed for about 30 years, replacing only 3% of calories from animal protein with plant protein reduced the risk of death by 34% if you replaced processed meat with plants, 19% if you replace eggs with plants, about 12% if you replace unprocessed red meat with plants, about 8% for dairy, and about 6% for poultry or fish. And in 2015, the World Health Organization declared processed meat a Group 1 human carcinogen and red meat a Group 2A or probable human carcinogen. And Group 1, basically you're in the same category as cigarettes, alcohol, asbestos, and arsenic. So not a good thing. So processed meat, we probably shouldn't be trying to raise money for cancer by selling hot dogs. Just not a good plan, which we see all the time. And so finally, I want to look at paleo diet versus, no, I got two things left. Paleo diet versus, plant-based diet versus keto paleo diets. We have very clear, consistent evidence that whole plant foods are protective to health, that heavily processed foods, fast foods, fried foods with added fat, sugar, and salt are damaging to health, and that meat, especially processed meat and red meat, increases risk of disease. And if you look at national and international dietary guidelines, they very clearly reflect this new reality, the World Health, or this recognized reality. The World Health Organization, in their 12 steps to healthy eating, step number one, eat a nutritious diet based on a variety of foods originating mainly from plants rather than from animals. The FAO, in their document, their 2016 document, Plates, Pyramids, and Planets, international, they highlighted in this document international leaders that promote a largely plant-based diet. Germany choose mostly plant foods. Brazil eat mainly foods of plant origin. Qatar emphasize plant-based diets, including vegetables, fruits, whole grains, cereals, legumes, nuts, and seeds. And the UK eat more plant-based foods, including at least 5 portions of fruits and vegetables a day. If you look at cancer organizations, healthy diet with emphasis on plants, mostly plants, mostly plants. And we see this consistently. The Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee in 2015 set a dietary pattern higher in plant-based foods such as vegetables, fruits, whole grains, legumes, nuts, and seeds, and lower in animal-based foods is more health-promoting and associated with less environmental impact than is the current U.S. diet. And now I have to share this with you because Canada's food guide is being revised, and these are the headlines we're seeing in our papers. New food guide's foundational statements may emphasize veggies, plant foods, plant-based food over meat. Food guide revamp encouraging plant-based low-meat diet as good for people in the planet. Canada's surprising new proposed health food guide or health guide favors plant-based foods and ignores industry input. So yay, we're proud of that. So why plant-based diets? Well, plant-based diets do something very simple. They minimize pathogenic dietary components and they maximize protective dietary components. When you look at protective factors, fiber, phytochemicals, plant enzymes, antioxidants, anti-inflammatory agents, pre and probiotics, macronutrients from plants, and micronutrients, which are, you know, plants are the most nutrient-dense foods we have. You look at this list and you see that they're basically exclusively or predominantly from plants. When you look at pathogenic factors, trans fats, excessive saturated fat, refined carbohydrates, excessive sodium, new 5GC, chemical contaminants, products of high temperature cooking, prooxidants, TMAO, endotoxins, these are dietary factors that are concentrated in one of two categories of foods, processed foods and animal products. And so the reality is most of what we eat is a threat to health, because probably 80% of what people eat in North America are in one of those two categories, processed foods and animal products. And so I want to take a quick peek at the good, the bad, and the ugly of low-carb diets. The good is that they emphasize, or they eliminate refined carbohydrates, starches like white flour products and sugars like sodas. They eliminate many highly processed foods. The bad is they're high in fat, saturated fat, and cholesterol. They're high in prooxidants and chemical contaminants. They're low in fiber, phytochemicals, and antioxidants. They have many potential nutrition shortfalls, especially with keto, many mineral, potential mineral and vitamin deficiencies, and the ugly. Low-carb diets are high animal food diets, period. They're ecologically unsustainable, and as far as I'm concerned, they're ethically unjustifiable. And it saddens me to see health professionals promoting these types of diets, with the single exception of therapeutic use of keto diets for epilepsy, and that is justifiable. When we think about ecological sustainability, low-carb diets downplay the ecological crisis that, to me, makes eating lower on the food chain an ecological imperative. You know, if our entire population ate a low-carb diet, our planet's dwindling resources would very quickly run dry. And in fact, Dr. David Katz did the math, and he said in his in one of the pieces he wrote on the paleo diet, if we all ate paleo, we would today need an estimated 15 planet Earths to sustain the current population. And I did the math based on his math, and if we continue to do so, we will need an estimated 26 planet Earths to sustain the population based on what our population is expected to be in the year 2100. The Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in 2016 released a report. By 2050, greenhouse gas emissions would be reduced by 29% if we all followed the global dietary guidelines to eat more fruits, vegetables, eat less meat, sugar, and calories, and by 70% if we all ate a vegan diet. And their recommendation, a global shift to a plant-based diet. You know, there was another study that I thought was kind of fun that looked at a typical steak and shrimp cocktail dinner in terms of carbon dioxide emissions, 816 kilograms of carbon dioxide emissions to put that steak and shrimp cocktail on someone's plate. This is the same as it would be to drive a relatively fuel-efficient car from LA to New York City. People need to recognize that. And a final thought is that these diets, to me, are really quite ethically unjustifiable. They're unjustifiable for people. If everyone ate a plant-based diet, the global calorie supply would increase by an estimated 50%, which could effectively wipe out hunger. And for animals, it makes no sense to me to be causing pain, suffering, and death in other living beings when it is not only absolutely unnecessary, we're killing ourselves in the process. 70 billion land animals are slaughtered for food every year. Most are raised in CAFOs, or confined animal feeding operations. and it's not good. And if everyone ate paleo, how many times would we multiply that number by? You know, the ultimate question to me is this: how can humans best adapt to their current environment to sustain a growing population on a shrinking planet? And it is a question that I don't think anybody promoting paleo or keto has considered. We, as human beings, have a choice. When we consider the consequences of our food choices, not just for ourselves, but beyond ourselves, a plant-based diet simply makes sense. And these are some keys to a long life. Avoid fatty meats, get daily exercise, and eat your veggies. Thank you.
Time. And you know, I spoke fast because I was scared. I had 146 slides. I thought I got to speak fast. Oh dear, I could have talked slower. I actually had somebody ask me a question about lectins and phytates, and so I definitely have time to answer that question before the talk. And one of the things that the paleo world claims is that you shouldn't eat beans because of lectins and you shouldn't eat grains because of phytates. And I want to address both of those because I think it's really important to recognize that there's probably one study that showed beans being dangerous because of lectins, and it was a study reporting on the consumption of undercooked kidney beans in a hospital. And you definitely, legumes contain lectins, but when you soak them, when you sprout them, when you cook them, you destroy the lectins, most of them, probably 98% plus of them. So cooking destroys lectins in about 20 minutes. We want to cook for even longer. You want it, as Vasanto said, be able to, you know, well cooked so that you can crush the bean on the roof of your mouth. I don't think, actually it's interesting too, if you look at research on lectins, you'll even see stuff about lectins being quite anti-carcinogenic, and some lectins are actually being used in research in Japan to prevent or treat cancer. So I think we need to be a little bit careful there, and certainly some people are more sensitive, and so people that are really sensitive to lectins, I think they need to be a little bit careful about using legume flour. And you know, especially in foods that are cooked for a very short period of time, and so we need to use some caution. Legumes need to be well cooked. Period. If they're well cooked, like lectins, are not an issue. Phytates reduce mineral absorption, no question. But they are anti-inflammatory, they're anti-cancer, they just do all kinds of good things. And so we need to have it's healthy to have a reasonable amount of phytates in the diet. We do not want to be sprinkling wheat bran over our food. Wheat bran is a little phytate bomb. It's loaded with phytates, and it can really compromise mineral absorption in a plant-based diet. We get plenty of phytates by eating a healthy variety of plant-based foods. We don't need to be sprinkling concentrated phytates on our food. And I've actually had a number of experiences with seniors who are, you know, using bran for everything, and their mineral status diminishes significantly, and we get them off the bran and onto just good whole foods, and they recover quite beautifully. So questions?
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
There's a lot of questions I guess the one I was thinking about was this issue of low-carb versus low-fat diet and what the endpoint is as far as cardiovascular risk. And I know just from reviewing this that there really hasn't been found a dramatic increased risk in a higher fat intake. In fact, there were some studies actually showing those that had a higher fat intake actually had a lower risk for CV endpoints. I just wanted to bring that up because I wonder about the, when we talk about what's good and what's bad, I agree with you that most of it has to be plant-based, but I think, especially when you compare the low-carb versus low-fat, what may be in the equation here is that it's mostly plant-based, mm-hmm. and either of those for success. I certainly found a lot of benefit in working with my diabetics to just say, go ahead and add fat to your diet. Diabetes is a risk factor for cancer, for cardiovascular mortality. There's no, and I was reviewing this, and there's not a very high compelling reason that there's a cardiovascular endpoint with a high fat diet. Go ahead and add fat in the diet right now. Work with slowly adding plants. A lot of people who have diabetes often have, issues with certain foods, and very low vegetable intake. So I just brought that up.
And I'm sorry, I wasn't able to hear everything clearly, and I'm not quite sure why my hearing's going, or...
Okay, so it was basically the issue about low fat versus low carb.
Yeah.
And I just wondered if maybe the issue was that both of those diets were healthier for plants.
Yeah, I always think of the Blue Zones as being a little bit of an acid test. And what's really interesting about the Blue Zones is their carbohydrates range from, 37 to 85% of calories, and they all do well. Their fat ranges from about 10% or 6% even in some of the Okinawan traditional diets to about 50% in Ikaria, Greece. And one of the things that I think is really important is more than the distribution of macronutrients is where the heck the macronutrients are coming from. So when macronutrients come from whole plant foods where they're loaded with fiber and phytochemicals and antioxidants and sterols and stanols and all of those things, people tend to do relatively well around the world when they're not living off of processed foods, they're living off whole foods and it's mainly plants. And so I think this is just a really important point. We've also seen, and I know, this is an issue raised. We've seen some studies that have showed high saturated fat, has been vindicated because of, for example, the Choudhury study and some of these studies that suggested saturated fat isn't an issue. But I think you need to look very carefully at those studies because, for example, Choudhury study, they compared. Between, you look at a population that's consuming, some people are consuming 12% of calories from saturated fat, some are consuming 14%. There's not a great difference between, everybody's eating high fat. And the Choudhury trial looked at within populations very narrow changes in saturated fat intake and compared those. They didn't compare between studies. So for example, Japan, which was consuming 5 or 6 or 7% saturated fat, had way lower rates of heart disease than the people consuming 12 or 14 in other places. The other thing about Choudhury that I think is really quite interesting is, when they first submitted that study to a journal to get published, the original findings were saturated fat increased risk 19%. And the study was actually turned down. They didn't publish it because it was nothing new. Saturated fat increases risk of heart disease. So they actually, the lead author actually reworked the data, removed some studies, and got something different and resubmitted it. And the third author in the study, or third or fourth, Francesca Crowe, I actually contacted her because she was involved in Epic Oxford studies. And Epic Oxford studies, is that huge 65,000 people that they've been following for years, comparing vegan, vegetarian meat eaters and all of that in the UK. And so I asked her, what's up with the study? And that's how I found out about how it was originally submitted. And she said, just one thing you need to know, this study absolutely, positively does not change one thing about what we should be recommending about saturated fat. She said the weight of the evidence against saturated fat is so strong. And in fact, if you look at the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association, the guidelines, it's still 5 to 6% as an upper limit for people who are at risk for heart disease. And there's a reason for that. So I think, you know, the weight of the evidence showing saturated fat increases LDL cholesterol is really pretty irrefutable. It's a strong grade A evidence. Any other questions? Come on. Okay, we'll give them a go. Oh, one more question. I don't know if I can still do 60 push-ups. I did at one conference, but I tore a rotator cuff. But I can try.
That actually wasn't my question. One thing that I found very striking was the World Health Organization classification of carcinogens. Now, processed meat being a class A carcinogen, was that right? And red meat all being one down from there?
Yeah, 2A, group 2A, yeah.
Yeah, could you tell us a little bit more about that? Because on the face of it, what that says to me is stay away from red meat, the same way you stay away from asbestos. Am I reading too much into that?
Yeah, so processed red meat is group 1. Definitely stay away from processed meat. There is no question it increases hugely risk of diabetes and of heart disease and of cancer. So processed red meat, I don't think there's any debate anymore. People should not be eating this stuff. Unprocessed red meat, as Walter Willett said, the ideal intake is probably zero. I think we have enough evidence against red meat to suggest that you know, if you look at the World Cancer Research Fund, the American Institute of Cancer Research, they recommend not more than 500 grams per week. I think it's 500 grams per week, something like that. Anyway, they're recommending a fair, if people are eating it, to keep the amounts small. The evidence for colon cancer, colorectal cancer, and red meat is really quite strong. And it's grown stronger over the years. I think when they originally did their 2007 book, it was, I think, probable cause, and then in 2011, the complete update project increased the rating to strong, convincing evidence that red meat causes colon cancer.
A question on saturated fat. There was a study published earlier this year where they put people for a month on added extra virgin coconut oil, extra virgin olive oil, or unsalted butter.
Yes.
And I think this was one, the lead author was one of Chowdhury's co-authors, too,
yes.
Call. Could you tell us your reaction to that?
Well, if it's a study I'm thinking of, they showed that butter was the worst.
Yes. but that the extra virgin coconut oil, because the outcome was LDL after a month.
Yeah.
But the olive oil did not worsen it, nor did the coconut.
Yeah, and I think there are a number of studies showing that coconut oil definitely does increase LDL cholesterol. I've probably seen at least a dozen studies showing that. So why it didn't in that study, I'm not sure. But definitely coconut oil is about 52% lauric acid, which is a 12-carbon fatty acid. And it has somewhat less of an impact than myristic or palmitic acid, which you would find more of in butter. So that would kind of explain the difference. But certainly, I think people need, you know, people think coconut oil is some sort of miracle cure for everything. Coconut oil is a refined, you know, we've extracted fat from a whole food. We've lost the fiber, we've lost a lot of the nutrients. I don't think it's ever that great of an idea to do, and you have to remember that of all of the foods, oil has the lowest nutrient density. It's a lot of 120 calories per tablespoon with very few nutrients. So when you're trying to treat a person with some sort of chronic disease, you're wanting high nutrient density, a lot of nutrients per calorie, because you're restricting calories to produce weight loss. And so we need to be very careful. People think that pouring olive oil all over their food is going to be some sort of miracle. They're sadly mistaken. They're just pouring gasoline on the fire, as far as I'm concerned, especially if they're eating a Western-style diet.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.